greatest trick the devil ever pulled was convincing the world he didn't exist.
Keep your friends close, but your enemies closer.
There are no two words in the English language more harmful than good job.
Welcome to the Make-Remake Literary License Podcast episode with Keith Shago and co-hosts Vicky Ray and Steve Templeman, discussing the original film and the remake, looking at what was improved upon, where they went wrong, and whether anything lives up to the original. Don't forget to have your say by commenting or sharing links, or just follow us below. Now on with the show!
What we've got here is failure to communicate.
You know how we used to look up in the sky and wonder at our place in the stars? Now we just look down and worry about our place in the dirt.
Hate is bad. Life's too short to be pissed off all the time. It's just not worth it.
Life.
See, in this world, there's two kinds of people, my friend. Those with loaded guns, and those who dig. You dig.
I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.
Yeah, well, you know, that's just like your opinion, man.
Hello, welcome to Literary License Podcast, and it's our new episode called Make-Remake, where we discuss the original and the remake. And before we get started, let's find out who's with us. We got Vicky Ray with us. Hello, Vicky.
Hey, haven't seen you in a long time.
No, whole 24 hours. and then myself, Keith Shago. Simon Templeman, unfortunately, can't be here due to work commitments, but he'll be here next month. So before we get started, let's find out what we've been up to. And I think you and I, Vicky, have been up to the same thing since yesterday, which is watching Texas Chainsaw Massacre on Netflix. What are your thoughts?
That was painful. I tried to find, like, okay, they did have a couple of good kills. Spoiler alert. Like where the guy's got his leg broken. Now that made me cringe, you know, where the good looking redneck got his leg broke and stuff. I was really rooting for the good looking redneck. Okay. But the good looking redneck died like in the, you know, after we got through 20 minutes of racism and climate change.
And gun control.
And gun control. Don't forget the gun control.
And the redneck was the only one that was good looking. The rest of them were quite ugly. I actually, it's not a very beautiful cast. They were a really ugly cast.
Yeah, the redneck was good looking. I got to remember where I seen him from. He was in something else. I didn't catch his name. It was driving me nuts.
Yeah, you know you're in for trouble when the only person you can find attractive is the redneck who hasn't looked like he's bathed, carrying a gun, and using a lot of diesel. And this is the one I find attractive. All the other people, I'm like, you're really ugly.
Yeah, but the bus scene, you got to say, you know.
Well, yeah, without giving too much away, obviously they never had fire drills when they were in school on the bus.
Obviously. That was just chaotic. But you got to love the one guy says, oh, buddy, he goes, don't be doing anything. He's holding his phone up to him. He goes, you're going to be canceled. Leatherface don't give a shit about that cancel stuff.
Yeah. Oh, no. What's going to happen to Leatherface's on Facebook page?
I know. They could have kicked Leatherface off of Facebook and Twitter.
I know. It was just a bit over egged, I think. I mean, the thing is, if they were just a normal bunch of people who said, oh, let's just build it. We got a ghost town here. Let's build it up and let's get a lot. But they kept they could have mentioned it like once, but they mentioned it over and over and over
about their utopia or their dystopia.
Yeah. And about, you know, inclusiveness and being accepting. And then the first person they come across that lives in this town, they're treating her like shit.
And she, yeah, they kill her basically because she doesn't want to leave her house, you know. So, yeah.
And the thing is, you can't just remove someone. I mean, there is a process you have to do anyway. So, yeah. You know, so, I mean, if the process was there and then they, you know, and then they showed that and then something happened and she died and stuff like this, then you go, oh, you know, Leatherface is in the wrong. But he's right. In the right because of the way they treated him, because it's like, it's their house.
Yeah. No one knew that Leatherface was a cannibal serial killer that was in an orphanage. He was just laying it out with Alice Creed. Well, everybody's seen this. We can't even do a spoiler alert on it because everybody's all a buzz. You either loved it or you hated it, or you tolerated this or that. You know, some people think it's the most brilliant piece of horror film they've ever seen already. You know,
no, it's not that. I mean, I think the problem basically is that the continuity. I mean, if you're going to connect,
they're trying to do continuity, but it doesn't fit, does it?
Well, you can't, because first of all, Leatherface has a family called the Sawyer family.
Right.
I mean, the first one happens. Okay, I'm going to be generous and say he's 25, though I think he probably was 30 plus. Right. Let's say he was 25. He's right. Living with his family. So even if his brother gets killed in the first one, gets run over, unless you include the Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2, and his brother lives and gets a metal plate. But anyway,
right.
You know. But even if you include the second one in on it, his family's alive. And when his family does die, he wouldn't be going to an orphanage at 25 years old.
No. And you got, there was something else that I was thinking about too. I mean,
if you're going to hide someone out, you don't hide them in a small town because everyone knows everybody's business in a small town. So everyone in that town would have known that this is Leatherface the killer that everyone's looking for.
And they were selling little Texas chainsaws, you know.
Precisely.
I know. I saw they still let you spend the night in the original store down there in Travis County. I've never gotten down there. I can't get anybody to go do anything with me.
Well, it was a restaurant for a little while.
Right. So. But now it's like a touristy attraction kind of thing. People can spend the night there and stuff.
Yeah, it's a very beautiful house. So
yeah, they have. I'm trying to think. The store I know is still operative, but I just didn't understand. I mean, I was trying to understand where they were coming from with it. I mean, it could have been if it was kind of some of the cast was okay, but it was a wasted cast. The ones that were good, and
I think the film that came out 2 years ago, Leatherface,
that's what I was trying to remember. Was it 2018 or 2016? Leatherface came out. I can't remember.
About 2018, 2019.
2018, because that was good. I really enjoyed that one. That kind of stuck to it.
But you know who directed that, don't you?
Is that was
the French directors who did Inside and Martyrs.
Oh yeah. Oh well, that would explain a lot. I love both of those movies. But I was sitting there thinking about, oh God, I just lost my train of thought. It was a good thought too. It was like a knockoff of Halloween. That was so Laurie Strode-ish, didn't you think?
Yeah, and actually, pretty Sally turned into a mean-looking lesbian by the, it looks like, in the later ages stage. That's because I don't know.
Sally Hardesty. I almost wish that they made that where she was in the movie genuinely like a full force of character as opposed to how she was presented. And I mean, they have her slaughtering pigs, for crying out loud. I doubt that's what she would have gone for after her life of crime fighting, you know?
Well, I mean, to be honest, I think that she should have gave Leatherface some money and said thank you to him, because if it wasn't for him, she would have been stuck with her irritating wheelchair-bound brother, Franklin, who was bloody horrible.
There was just too many Franklins in this movie for me, don't you think?
Yeah. Oh, I hated Franklin in the original. When he died, I was like, thank Christ. It's like, you know, the thing is, and if he lived and they lived, they survived, then she would have been stuck with him for the rest of her life. So he did, you know, Leatherface did her a favor.
He kind of did. Was that a Tesla in the end?
I don't know. It's like, you know, it auto drives. It's like, I don't know. That's like, it's auto driving. It's like, I don't know. Spoiler alert, but I thought that was like, oh my God, really?
I don't know. Nothing says it better to me than good old American gas and diesel. I'm sorry. It's like, no.
I mean, another thing is that you know that if you're going to kill somebody and they're like unstoppable and you finally do kill them, you double tap their head. You know what I mean? So
I don't understand how he didn't die in this one either. But like I said, there's total spoilers. If you don't want to hear it, don't hear it. But everybody's talking about it on the internet today anyway. It's like Twitter baiting everywhere. Everybody's bitching at each other on Facebook about it. Of course, I got my goods in there. I had somebody, a couple people gave me some good answers though to my, you know, my answer. And so there was really good points on both sides, whether you liked it or not. And what do you, I mean, you just can't top that first Chainsaw movie. I'm sorry. You just can't top Tobe Hooper's Chainsaw.
Oh, I like the second one. That's directed by Tobe Hooper as well. Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2.
Oh, wait. Okay. Who was in that one?
Dennis Hopper.
Oh, Dennis Hopper. My husband was just talking about that. We can't find, I told him, I go, I think it's all the Texas Chainsaws are on Netflix right now because this one came out. I mean, I've started watching the original because I needed to get back to my roots after watching that. I just knew that oh my God, I wanted to give it a fair chance. I did. But it was probably one of the worst movies I've seen in a long time. And that's saying, I could tolerate a lot. But there was a couple of good kills. There was a couple of good ones. So
yeah, there's some good kills in it. I'll give it that. Now I think the best Texas Chainsaw Massacres is the original, of course. I like the second one Dennis Hopper. Good. And that was pretty much banned because, I mean, it's really hard to find. They very rarely show it on streaming because
you don't hear or see about it anymore much.
Well, it's because it's very, very disturbing.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that's actually more disturbing than the first one, actually.
Yeah. Disturbing, but
when he's beating that guy over the head with a hammer over and over and over and then, you know, I mean, there's a lot of disturbing stuff in there.
What about the one with what's her face? She played in. She's really beautiful. Oh,
Renee
God.
Zellweger.
No, the second the one that came out in 2016.
Oh, Lily Taylor.
Yeah, did you like that one?
She was brilliant because she played the mom, didn't she? But Lily Taylor's always brilliant. So
yeah, I like that one. But what's her name? I can't remember the actors in it. I liked who they had in it. That was a legit one. It was kind of okay. They were going to they kept it where they were going to a Leonard Skinner concert, stuff like that. So I mean, they didn't really stray from it. They had a lot of pot in the car, but
you're talking about the remake
from
the 2000s, back when they were remaking everything. That was okay, yeah. And then they did a prequel to that, didn't they?
Mm-hmm. So, what was the one with the prequel? She was she's the goth. She was related to Leatherface. She was his sister.
Oh, no, that was another one.
Yeah, that was another one. Yeah. There's so many. The franchise, we talk about, what was it? We were talking about Halloween never has any continuity as far as all together. Well, this one's just foobar too, because there is no continuity with any of them all wrapped up together. You got different people doing different narratives and stuff. But this one was definitely, it was just weird. I was expecting Greta Thunberg to walk out at any moment.
I don't know. It's just like, I mean, it's filmed well. I'll give it that.
It's filmed well. It did.
But let down by a bad script, really.
Yeah, I just thought it was, I think that they knew they were being over the top. Do you think that they meant to be over the top like that?
I think you can get over the top, but at some point you got to be rooting for someone and you don't root for any of them. You don't care about any of them. That's the problem.
I was rooting for Leatherface and Alice Krieg. Mm-hmm. I felt bad. As soon as they get there, they basically kill an old woman by giving her a heart attack that took care of little boys for years and years because they say it's her home. And they didn't even buy the place. They didn't have any of the deeds. And that guy was just a real asshole. So, you know, then the redneck takes their keys. They can't leave.
And then the Dixie flag thing. And I mean,
flag. Why do we have to throw all that shit in there? Can't we just have a horror movie?
And why didn't they, you know, I'm surprised they didn't tear down the statue in the middle of the park.
I know, I saw the Confederate statue and I go, oh my God, they're going to tear down the Confederate statue. Here we go. But they didn't do it. But you notice how they kept showing it?
Yeah, over and over.
They kept showing it. It's like, ah, damn. We're not even going to have a good history lesson. But you just can't top the first two. You can't.
No.
There's no way. And you're right, Dennis Hopper, that was a disturbing version. I might have to find that again and watch it.
Yeah, watch the unrated version. That's even worse.
Yeah, if you can find it. I can't even find it on physical, you know.
It's on Amazon.
Is it? I'm going to have to find it. Yeah. I'm getting like Joe. Cover. I'm starting to realize that I probably need to buy these things because they're all going to disappear on me unless this crazy new, you know, cancel culture goes away. So,
yeah. It's true. So
pretty soon they're going to cancel me and you.
Yeah, well, let them try. There's a lot more people who think like me than a lot more people who think like them. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, it is true. So y'all over your storm over there?
Yep, it's cold and a bit rainy and chilly now.
I think Craig sent me video of police and people just being blown all over the street. Did he send that video to you? I was laughing. I go, oh my God, I didn't know it got that windy in the UK.
Well, it was pretty bad, actually. Someone got beheaded by a stop sign because...
You've got to be kidding me. Oh, my God. Really?
No, because the wind caught tore the sign off the post, and then it went... cut someone's head off. Well, the wind got up to 120 miles per hour.
That's almost... That is hurricane force at 70. What the hell? Would you guys inherit one of our nor'easters kind of just drift across the pond or what?
I think we got the storm that New York got a couple days earlier. So.
Yeah, it looks like.
But we survived. Well.
Yeah, well, it's sturdy stock over there.
So I guess this brings us to our feature. For our first Make-Remake episode, we'll be covering Imitation of Life from 1934, and Imitation of Life from 1959. A little bit of background first, though, is that Imitation of Life started out as a popular novel in 1933, which was written by Fanny Hurst, and it was added into two successful films by Universal Pictures. The book actually deals with issues of race, class, and gender, and was originally serialized in 1932 in the magazine Pictorial Review under the title Sugar House. Now, the first film, Imitation of Life, is 1934, is an American drama film directed by John M. Stahl, the screenplay by William Colbert, based on Fanny Wright's 1933 novel, and was augmented by eight additional uncredited writers, including Preston Sturges and Finley Peter Dunn. The film stars Claudette Colbert, Louise Beavers, Warren Williams, Rochelle Hudson, and Freddie Washington. The film was originally released by Universal Pictures on November 26, 1934, and was re-released in 1936. In 2005, Imitation of Life was registered for preservation in the United States National Film Registry and being deemed culturally, historically, and aesthetically significant. It was also named by The Times in 2007 as one of the 25 most important films on race. It was nominated for Best Picture, Best Assistant Director, and Best Sounding Recording at the 7th Academy Awards.
You're back.
Yes, Mother. And I want to tell you how sorry I am for what I did to you.
Oh, that's all right. Come. Come, baby. And sit down. It don't feel like you're really here standing so far off.
Mother, I've done everything you wanted me to. I went to that school and tried to be happy there to please you. But I just couldn't bear it. I couldn't. I had to get away.
I understand, baby. We're going to forget all about it now. It's all right.
But it isn't all right, Mother. I want to talk to you.
I'll go upstairs, Delilah.
No, Miss B. You stay, please. I want you to hear, too.
What's my little baby got on her mind?
I want to go away.
Go away? Go where, Piola?
By that I mean, I want to go away. And you mustn't see me, or own me, or claim me, or anything. I mean... Even if you pass me on the street, you'll have to pass me by. Oh, no, Paola. Oh, I know it's terrible of me, Miss B. But you don't know what it is to look white and be black. You don't know. I can't go on this way any longer. I can't give up my baby. I bore you. I nursed you. I love you. I love you more than you can guess. You can't ask your mammy to do this. You've got to promise me, mother. I'm your mammy, child. I ain't no white mother. It's too much to ask of me. I ain't got the spiritual strength to meet it. I can't hang on no cross. I ain't got the strength. You can't ask me to unborn my own child. I'm sorry, mother. I know it's asking a lot. But I've got to live my own life. Bye.
Bill, how can you hurt your mother so? How can you make her suffer this way?
I'm sorry, Miss B, but I can't help it.
So, Vix, what's your view on 1934 Imitation of Life film?
I've never seen this before, and I thought it was excellent. I mean, not only was it old and it was pretty to look at, you know, the black and white silver screen, whatever, but it really was culturally, historically, and aesthetically significant. I thought it was ahead of its time because, I mean, that this is something that you would probably seen coming later on before. Well, this is all pre-civil rights era, so it is what it is. And I just thought it was kind of a heartbreaking film. I really was like bawling towards the end of it because it was so sad. You really felt for these women. And even now women get together because sometimes women need other women to survive. They just do. These two, one was white, one was black. They realized they needed each other to survive in the world and to help each other. And you had the one daughter. I mean, the mother really did look like somebody's mammy. I mean, for real. And the daughter looked just as white as anybody, like, you know, regular, you know, white Caucasian person. So, but even now, when you think about it, you have seen, I have also known people, this is going to get me in trouble probably, that sometimes when they are lighter colored, they're not really wanted by either, you know, back then, back from their own, you know, their people. I hate to say it that way, or, you know, Caucasian people, because it was it was really bad back then. We all know that. But, you know, it really looked at something. And I think with all kinds of sincerity at a problem that, you know, pre-civil rights America was dealing with or what these people were dealing with. And you really felt sorry, or you really felt something for the characters. And we always talk about that. Are you vested in the characters? Do they make you feel anything? And if you've got to feel something for this. It's just it's just good acting. It's good script writing. It's just a great movie. You know, and like I said, it's sad. It is really sad. And you can see the kernel of truth that runs right through it. You know, when you're talking, when we beat the shit out of stuff and we're kidding around about stuff, you know, woke this. This is actually a human struggle. You know, it has validity. This is what it's all about. You know, and what people really did have to endure, you know, pre-civil rights.
I also have to sit there and say that what I quite liked about this film is that she's treated as an equal as well. So she comes in, she helps out with the house and stuff like this. And Claudette Colbert's character, or B. basically has a molasses...
maple syrup company.
And you know, the black woman Delia basically has a great pancake recipe.
Yep.
So instead of her stealing the recipe from her, they open a restaurant together and she makes her equal partner. And the woman's not very educated, so you know she doesn't know much about money. But
she's got a huge, warm heart. She's a beautiful person. She really is.
But B doesn't take advantage of her whatsoever and gives her 50-50% of the company, which she should, and then puts it, everything into a bank account for her. So,
yeah.
And then you find out it's like, you know, it's a multi-million dollar company. And then you think to yourself that this woman's got all this money in the bank and she doesn't care about it. But all that money's there, which will, you know, pays for a will pay for a funeral later on. Yeah. But she's treated as an equal. She's not treated as a servant in this one. And I thought
well,
that
she's
was
a
quite
best friend, a business partner, a confidant, you know, another mother, you know, to these two girls who are totally two different entities, too.
And another thing is with the little girl in this one, and we'll go more when we hit the 1959, we'll discuss how that's done. But the little girl doesn't really deal with the whole passing thing until she becomes like a teenager. And then that's all of a sudden when she becomes more aware that she needs, you know, she needs to start passing. She's ashamed of her African-American heritage. And
ashamed of her mother.
Yeah. And the thing is, you were kind of watching it. And I was discussing this with girls at work. I deal with I have three black secretaries that work with me. One's from Nigeria, one's from her family's from the Caribbean, and the other one was born here and she's second generation
right
from St. Lucia. And they were talking about passing. She goes, it still happens today. People pass all the time today. And I go, what do you think about that?
This is the first time I've heard that term. What is that term, actually? Are they trying to pass as white? So passing, yeah, passing meant then they were trying to pass as white.
Yeah, or passing. Passing would be like if you're, let's sit there and say that you're dark skin. Let's say that you're darker, you're a white, dark skin person and you're trying to pass as Latino.
Right.
Or Carmel Harris. Or who's that woman? Who's that? Who's that? Who's that politician?
Pocahontas.
Yeah,
it's got 1.1 and 10,024th.
Yeah, she's telling everyone she's Native American. Yeah,
yeah. So she could go to college. Yeah.
I mean, if you think about it, a lot of Americans think that they have Native American blood in them. It's like, what, was Native American women just whores? Were they just sleeping with everyone? It's like, how can all these people have Native American blood in them? It's like, oh, and they all, I got some Native American blood in me. He's like, do you? He's like, either an Indian person, a Native American slept with a white woman, which would not have gone over well, or vice versa, which would not have gone over well.
Right.
She'd been a, like, such, she'd been a social outcast, it's, you know, back in the day. So, yeah, I doubt that all these people running around saying they have Native American blood in them is a bunch of bullets. So right now we've probably got about 80% of the American population passing as having Native American blood in them.
Right.
Only
20%
of it's probably true. But so passing is basically there. But you know, if you think of the ramifications of passing, if you decide that, you know, I can understand why someone would do it, especially in this time,
well, because to get
then.
Along, she would have had more opportunity passing as a Caucasian as opposed
education.
To a black person.
Well, she'd have education, job opportunities, better.
Well, her mother
in
did
life.
Say what did get rich and did try to send her to a Negro college back then, you know. But I guess that probably I don't know much about that, I will admit. But I mean, she tried to, but would she be accepted by her own in that college?
Well, we don't really know about the acceptance or how she gets on with them, because there's no other African Americans in the movie, so we don't know how that goes. But we know that, but the question is, if she went to a African American college, would she, what kind of job would she have outside of that? She wouldn't be working on Wall Street if she wanted to be an investment
right.
banker. She wouldn't be able to work in a as a doctor, maybe, but only in a poor black area, probably.
Right.
You know, so, but another thing you have to look at it from her point of view is that if you're passing, you have to let go of your whole family. And it's not like, I mean, I can understand the benefits of it, but there are some huge disadvantages. Like,
oh God, I could never give up my family because of a race situation. But, you know, when she was a little girl, if you remember going back a little bit, her mother, we're so worried about her not having her coat and her rubber boots because it was really raining bad. And no one really understood. Even Claudette Colbert in the beginning said that you didn't understand that this was her daughter because she was so light skinned. Mm-hmm. And so the whole class knew at that time what was going on. And chances are they wouldn't have allowed her in that school, would they, if they knew she was passing as a white person?
Well, the problem basically is you find out that once it's revealed that I think the daughter at some point says there, you know, she has to change schools for the simple fact that the kids are making fun of her.
Yeah,
and
they're going to be cruel.
And the two girls cut themselves to see if their blood's the same.
Yeah, that's right. Afterwards. I forgot about that. Yeah. That isn't, because back then, you know, I just don't think in those terms, I guess, because I'm more modern. I guess had I grown up then, I do talk to people that, you know, back in the day, they all had a different culture and a different mentality set, a mindset for back then. I think we've gotten over that, or at least I'd hope we have in real life, real time. Mm. But.
Well, another thing, if you pass and you do get married and.
Could the children be black? I mean, is that going to be a problem?
Well, that's the thing about genetics. Genetics have the way of, it might skip your generation, but it'll come out eventually.
Yeah. Yeah. Like,
What happened to Dinah Shore, didn't it?
I vaguely remember that story. What happened now? Was her mother?
No, her great-grandmother.
Was a woman of color?
Was a woman of color. And basically, she didn't know. It was kind of like hidden. So basically, here's Dinah Shore, blonde hair, blue eyed, as white as they can be.
Dating Burt Reynolds.
She gets married and no, she had a baby with someone else. It wasn't Burt Reynolds' child. She dated Burt Reynolds.
But she was dating him. Yeah.
But she was married to a prominent producer and they had a baby and the baby came out looking African-American.
Gosh, I don't remember that. I remember the controversy, but I don't remember a baby. I'm going to have to go back and look that up.
It happened like in the early 60s. She almost lost her job. She almost lost her career. She lost her husband because her husband thought she was having an affair. And it's only after like 5 or 6 years of her figuring out figuring out her lineage that it all came out, that she found out about it.
Well, Queen Sophia was a black woman, wasn't she? You know, basically. Yeah. No one talks about her. I'm sure they clutch their pearls still in the royal family, but not anymore. I guess the royal family's definitely did a complete about face when it comes to all that, though.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we're living in a different time back then, but I mean, if you are passing, that's another thing. You're spending your whole life looking behind your shoulders because you don't want anyone to find out.
Yeah.
So
and imagine back in the 30s, that was probably 10 times worse. Because you still had idiots that were trying to lynch people and hurt them.
I say this is probably a problem up until like 1968.
Yeah. Well, pre-civil liberties, definitely.
Black people couldn't vote until 1967.
Yeah, aren't we? That's so primitive, just to even think. You know what? I see like the older black people here in Texas. And I always try to make extra sure I'm really... like really polite to them because one, they got a story. I like listening, you know, I do listen. And two, you know, those poor people had to use another bubbler or another bathroom. And, you know, I mean, I've actually seen where it gone into the old buildings and I was working for a municipality and they were going to redo it. And it did say black and white. And it was like that all these years that had been untouched and I've just never actually seen it. And it really is kind of wow, you know.
Well, yeah. Well, see, you and I, we come from the North, and we didn't have all that in the North. The North was totally different.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, we didn't have segregation. We didn't have any of that where we grew up. The house that I grew up in has a cave underneath, and that was used for the Underground Railroad, where they would smuggle old slaves into Canada for freedom.
Yeah, there's a church on Morrison Street in Watertown that's a landmark, not too far from your sister's, where it was an Underground Railroad. What's the name of that church? It's good. You know which one I'm talking about. It's right down the road. But that's been there. That finally got the historic registry. Finally.
Yeah. And I mean, our house was, you know, the house where we lived in was used for that back in the 1800s. But it's like. You know, but the thing is, we lived in the North, so we didn't actually experience any of that kind of stuff because we don't really have that up North, you know.
We wouldn't have known what to do with it, to tell you the truth. I mean, I never really noticed, even that we had a small black population before Fort Drum got bigger. But, you know, we didn't see color when we were kids. I know we didn't.
Well, yeah, I mean, we just kind of just got on with it, you know, sort of thing. And, you know, I know that my mom, you know, one time my sister shouted something at one of the Johnson's kids. And my mom took her right up there, and basically she had to apologize. And my sister had to work for them for 3 weeks. You know,
good mother.
And she's like, because she's like, you don't talk to people like that. You respect people. She goes, if they do something to you, then fine. Then you can do something back. But she goes, you know, you don't disrespect people based on anything. She goes, I don't care if it's religion or race or whatever it is. You just be polite to them.
Right.
And if, you know, if any, I remember if anyone said anything stupid in front of my mom, she'd be like, oh, your ignorance is showing. That's what she used to tell people. Your ignorance is showing. You might want to shut up.
Well, so. That's when we kind of respected what our parents used to say, you know, before we did all this.
Well, I mean, we didn't have the KKK or anything like that either, because if we had the KKK on some,
they were around. They were around.
They were, yeah, but the mafia would normally would take care of them. So we were more mafia in our area. I mean, there's more of the mafia and that kind of stuff going on under, you know, not in the foreground. It wasn't like New York Godfather.
It wasn't like Vito Corleone.
If anything, like these kind of groups, these hatred groups came up, I mean, they kind of silenced them very quickly, and they, you know. The families of these groups would never be seen again. It's like, oh,
what happened? We never saw them, did we? They did kind of disappear, now that you think about it. It wasn't tolerated, all that asshole attitude. No, you missed that too. So.
I remember getting some KKK information in our letterbox once. And my mom pulled it out of my hand. She goes, give me that. She made a phone call. And we never got any information. We never got anything ever again. So I don't know who she phoned or what was going on. I mean, I was really young. So
there was jerks even up there. I mean, they're around, but we just didn't see them.
You got idiots everywhere, sort of.
Yeah.
Thing.
Just now, to do with it.
Now, the interesting thing about this is that Universal borrowed Warren Williams from Warner Brothers for the male lead, but the studio had first wanted Paul Lucas for the part.
Right.
The parents of the child playing Jesse as a baby changed their name from Baby Jane to Juanita Quigley during the production of the film, and Claudette Colbert was borrowed from Paramount. Now, this is what's quite interesting about this film. Universal had a difficulty receiving approval from the censors at the Hays office for the original script they submitted for Imitation of Life. Joseph Breen objected to the elements of passing in the story, which not only violates the production code, but is very dangerous from the standpoint both of industry and public policy. He rejected the project, writing, Hearst novel dealing with a partly colored girl who wants to pass as white violates the clause covering passing in spirit, if not in fact. The production code of administration censors had difficulty negotiating how boundaries of racial difference should be cinematically constructed to be seen and believed on the screen. Which is kind of like, I mean, it's amazing that the film was made. I mean, if they're going like that, so that you can't even show this. I mean, you know, it's quite interesting. But I mean, at the end, I mean, they kind of missed it around, and basically they had to move some language out of the script. There was a scene where a young black man is nearly lynched for approaching a white woman, and that was exercised from the original script. And then basically they took out. Now, the book is a little bit different. In the book, she keeps passing. Her mom dies. She doesn't go back to her funeral. She marries a white guy, and they move to Bolivia, never to be heard from again. That's how the book ends. And Claudette Colbert, the mother, the white mother and daughter, the daughter falls in love with the guy. The guy gets a little bit too frisky with the daughter. The mother kills the boyfriend. They bury the body and they never discuss it again. And that's how the original book ends.
Right. Makes so more sense.
We don't get any of that here, sort of thing, unfortunately.
But they did say in the, when you're talking about the themes, they said some of them were filmed to highlight fundamental unfairness of the Delilah's social position. While, and this was a good example, because I noticed this and I'm glad that I found notes on it. While living in Bee's fabulous New York City mansion, Delilah descends down the shadowy stairs to the basement where her rooms are. Bee, dressed in the height of fashion, floats up the stairs to her rooms, whose luxury was built from the success of Delilah's recipe. You know, but she does. She's in the basement sleeping still. And she is floating upstairs with her beautiful finery. So what gives with that? Was that supposed to just show the differences? Because if they were partners, wouldn't she should have been upstairs as well instead of should being in the basement?
You think she'd have her own wing of the house?
Yeah, easy. I mean, and she didn't fit it, split it. She split it 20%. She gave her 20%, not 50-50.
Yeah, I mean, there are some indifferences. I mean, I said there.
Was Claudette Colbert, was she awake as opposed to woke? Was she a nice person that didn't see color? Because why is?
Well, I think there are some still social constructs there for the simple fact that, I mean, I have to sit there and say, I don't want to go into the 1959 one's a lot worse.
Yeah,
1934 yes. one. I mean, it does seem like there's more of an equality between the two women,
right?
But at the same time, yes. But I don't know how much of his artistic license that basically showed that, you know, having her go up into the light and being finally dressed and having Delilah go down to, you know, going down to a dark basement. Now, the thing is, I doubt that Delilah's rooms are all dark and dingy sort of thing.
No. Because,
but I think that's more showing an artistic light on basically the differences in society where they are sort of thing. You know, I said before, I mean, when you see Delilah's bedroom, I mean, it's nicely furnished and stuff like that when she's dying. So,
yeah,
you know what I mean?
Putting aside race for a second, though, it was really ahead of its time as well, because you have two women, black and white, are entrepreneurial spirit. You know, they're trying to, you know, they're making money in a man's world still, and they struggle to do it.
I mean, I think, there are some scenes where that Delilah seems to be a bit simple when it comes to business matters and stuff like that.
Well, yeah. I mean, God, I wouldn't want to handle all that either. But, you know, you got Claudette Colbert robbing Peter to pay Paul the whole first 20 minutes, you know, of the movie. She's kind of smart. Well, we'll do this and we'll just start paying it off in a month or 2 months, you know. So they were smart women when it came to that. I mean, one of them had to have, you know, one of them had to, you know, have the recipe. One of them had to have the business smart. So I kind of got that.
Yeah. And I think, you know, and she's not a maid in the house. She's not, you know.
She likes to take care of the family in the house. That just makes her feel.
She takes care of them, but she's not the maid. You know what I mean?
No, they do have other people.
Yeah.
And then after 10 years, they're both wealthy and they share that mansion. That's why I don't understand why she kept descending into the abyss.
Well, I think, to be honest, I mean, the thing is, we don't see where Delilah's living quarters are. I mean, for all we know, there could have been a living room and she could just have like a basement apartment that was fully lavishly furnished.
Oh, right.
For all we know. You know, because we don't really, you know, we don't really see Claudette Colbert's house except for the living room. Really?
Yeah, true.
You know,
they did get nominated for 3 Academy Awards. You know, it's kind of sad that it didn't get one, though.
Well, I mean, the controversy probably didn't help matters much.
Do you think that people just didn't want to pay attention to something like that, just keep sweeping it under the rug back then and not have a movie? Well, I mean, it was obviously a good enough movie to be nominated.
Well, I have to sit there and say that of all the black women that I work with, this Imitation of Life, they love it. They say it's one of their favorite movies.
It's very heartfelt. It is. But, you know, the person who really is the star of the show and they kind of is the rebellious daughter that is light skinned, who's black, but she doesn't look it. And
well,
you know,
she was played by Freddie Washington, which is quite interesting because he said that after this movie came out, reportedly received a great deal of mail from young blacks thanking her for having expressed her intimate concerns and contradictions so well. One may add that Stahl's film was somewhat unique in its casting of a black actress in this kind of part, which was to become a Hollywood stereotype of sorts, because they would actually cast Italians or someone else in this role, which we'll see in the next one. But they actually used a mixed race actress.
She was of mixed race. I didn't know that.
Yeah, so. But, yeah, I mean, the thing, I think this one, I think that Delilah is treated as equal as you can during the night, during this time period. The thing is, I'm not quite sure. I mean, there's nothing. See, another thing, I think it all depends on where this takes place, because you're not really quite sure where it is, but we know that she's peddling maple syrup. So I'm guessing they're somewhere in the northern parts of America.
It was kind of a screaming New Jersey, New York to me for some reason. I don't know why. It could have been somewhere else. I wonder if I can like Google that really quick. What city? Because that, you know, it's going to drive me nuts now.
They're Jersey Shore in Pleasantville.
Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah. It kind of screamed Jersey to me a little bit. Oh, yeah. That's because they were on they were Coney Island. No, is that the second movie I'm getting it mixed up with?
No, that's the second movie sort of thing. So, you know, they are in the north, so there would have been a bit more equality than normal anyway. I mean, I have to sit there and say that we didn't see any kind of prejudice going on towards Delilah from any people that's coming into the household. There wasn't, you know, her business partner and everyone like that treated Delilah as an equal. So we do have that going on in the movie. She wasn't expected to get people's drinks and stuff when people arrived at the house. So that wasn't going on in this version. So I would say Delilah for the time period was as much as an equal as she could be at this time in history.
But what a beautiful human being she portrayed her as, though. I mean, it was really, I think I was talking to one of my friends the other day ago. We've always had issues about children, you know, with the exes, like hiding them or taking them away. And the one scene that just really gets to you as a mother is how she's watching her through the window.
Yeah.
You know, and she knows she's kind of untouchable. That's just heartbreaking. You know, and then she dies, and then she realizes what a little bitch she was to her mother, and she throws herself on the casket in the hearse, you know, say, "I'm sorry, I'm sorry." It's just like, you're a day late and a dollar short, lady. You know, she was such a beautiful person. She loved her, you know, she loved, I feel bad for her because that's her whole joy in life was a daughter who resented her, you know.
I don't think she resented her. I just think that she didn't want the life that her mom had. And she did. I think it was more of that, actually. I don't think it was resentment of her mom. Because the thing is, she would say that and then she feel really bad. So she felt bad. But
didn't she look irritated with her mother when she kept trying to hold her? You know, it was sort of like that cartoon, and I will call him George and I will hug him and kiss him and squeeze it. But she always seemed like, she, you know, less that one last hug she gave her. She just didn't want to deal with it.
Yeah, but I think to me, I fed that to the simple fact that it's not that she didn't want to deal with it. It's just that if she goes down this route and does what her mom says, she's not going to have her life's going to be just like her mom's. Her mom lucked out because she came up with a decent you know, she met a decent woman who was willing, you know, and they decided to do business together. But what's she going to do?
Yeah.
What's her hope going to be? What, being a housekeeper? Yeah. Being a maid?
Yeah, but
working in a shop.
But they had their money. They had money. She would have been taken care of the rest of her life. She wouldn't have had to go out there and prove herself, really.
Well, she would have to marry a black man.
Well, yeah, and, unless there is a white man out there that isn't, you know, really concerned about that stuff. But this is the 30s.
Well, I mean, yeah, she could meet a European, which would have been a lot different.
Yes.
But I mean, but you also have to remember that when she runs away, she can only get Piola can only get a job in a segregated restaurant. She can only serve white people. That's the job that she got. And so I thought it was quite interesting that when you saw the different jobs that she had, that she's making money and supporting herself, there were only jobs that white people could have.
Right.
So they did show those. So, you know, I mean, you know, at the end of this movie, you know, after she dies and she, you know, she has that regret. And the thing is, you do regret, you know, you act this way and you think of yourself, but then when someone's gone, you know, that it can come back, and it does kind of change your view of everything anyway.
Death does. It kind of sobers you up a little bit to what the initial. I mean, I felt so bad for the mom because all she did was just love her kid, you know, and her daughter was so resentful of her mother for being black. And apparently the father struggled with it too, because he was light skinned as well.
He ran off on them because he didn't want to be seen with a black woman.
Yeah.
I mean, she does mention that.
Yeah.
He couldn't accept me for my darkness, so we never saw him again. That's what she says.
Yeah, that's so sad. God, that's just brutal. I just can't imagine.
I mean, after the funeral, Paola, I mean, there is retribution here. Paola decides she's going to return to college. B asked Stephen to wait, promising to come to him after Jesse is over her infatuation. And at the end, B starts to tell Jesse about her instant demands for her and Quack Quack and the day they met Delilah. And so the good thing, I guess, what we find out is that, which is quite clear in this, is that Paola is still going to be part of their family, you know, yeah. And Delilah was part of their family. And with Delilah's death, Delilah is treated with so much respect all the way through the movie. But even in death, there's this respect for her.
Yeah. It's so sad, though. It was such a sad movie. Sad. It was. And I just thought it was so beautifully filmed, too. There's just something about that old black and white silver screen stuff that just kind of captivates you, I guess.
So I think this brings us to the 1959 version of Imitation of Life, which is American drama filmed and directed by Douglas Sirk and was produced by Ross Hunter, who also did Madam X and all those kind of films of those in this time. It was released by Universal International. It was Sirk's final Hollywood film and dealt with issues of race, color, and gender. Imitation of Life starred Lana Turner, John Gavin, and the cast also includes Sandra Dee, Dan O'Hillery, Susan Kohner, Robert Alda, and Juanita Moore. Kohner and Moore received Academy Award nominations for their performance, and gospel music star Mahalia Jackson appears as the church choir.
I knew that was Mahalia Jackson. Boy, that woman had a set of pipes on her.
In 2015, the United States Library of Congress selected this version of Imitation of Life for preservation in the National Film Registry, finding it culturally, historically, and aesthetically significant. The original 1934 version of Imitation of Life, as we said before, was added to the National Film Registry in 2005. So what we're going to do is cut to the trailer and be right back.
But you've always had that.
Yes, by telephone, by postcard, by magazine interviews. You've given me everything but yourself.
I'm white. White. White!
Starring Lana Turner as the great stage star Laura Meredith, the men in her life, John Gavin, Dan O'Herlihy, Robert Alda.
If the Dramatist Club wants to eat and sleep with you, you eat and sleep with them.
It's disgusting.
It pays off.
Her daughter, Sandra Dee, Susan Kohner, who was born to be hurt.
I don't want to have to come through back doors or feel lower than other people or apologize for my mother's color.
Don't say
she can't help her color. But I can.
Juanita Moore, hers was the shame and the pain.
There, Jane Johnson. You put your clothes on and get out of this place.
And the incomparable Mahalia Jackson.
Traveler of the world, I'm going home.
I'm not asking you not to go down there, Laura. I'm telling you.
And what makes you think you have that right?
Because I love you. Isn't that enough?
No, Steve, I'm sorry.
All the kids talking behind my back.
Is it true?
No.
Are you black?
No, I'm as white as you.
You're lying.
I'm not.
I'd like to hold you in my arms once more. Like you were still my baby.
All right.
Oh, Sarah Jane.
Oh, my baby. Oh, Mama.
Oh. An invitation. An invitation.
Welcome back to the Literary License Podcast. We discussed Imitation of Life from 1959. So, what's your view on the 1959 one?
It was a little different, wasn't it? I mean, they kind of, you know, they took out the business and put Lana Turner in the role of Mrs. What was her name? That's going to drive me nuts. Mrs. Pullman. They kept calling her Mrs. Pullman in the first one all the time. But
yeah, she's Laura Meredith in this one.
Instead of being like the pancake queens, she was the she became a not Hollywood, but she became a
model
Broadway
actress.
She became a theater actress and did very well at it, apparently. But I thought that the parts of what did they call her? What was Juanita? Annie. They called her Annie.
Yeah.
Played by Juanita Moore in this. And I thought that they kind of took a more, I don't know. I thought that the other one, I thought the other one was better, by the way, but I kind of thought that I don't think the message kind of got out there that, I mean, the friendship was still tight, but there was, I don't know what it was about Lana.
This one was a lot more racist. I'm sorry.
That's what I'm trying to say. It was more racist. I mean, and then when you know, you got Tab Hunter. Was that Tab Hunter that was smacking around? I'm pretty sure that was Tab Hunter.
Troy Donahue.
Okay. I mean, I didn't even know that was Troy Donahue until I started going through the film credits. It's like, oh my God, that is Troy Donahue. But who was it? Not Sandra D, but Sandra Kohner.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. She was at age 18. She was a little older than Sandra D, as Susie was. But this was a little more aggressive, I guess. And it was a little more, I mean, okay, let's say it was almost 30 years later. So it is going to be a little more aggressive and a little more modern, you know, but it was more of a hostile movie than the other one was. I can't think that's
well true. There, I mean, I have problems with this because, first of all, because there's no business, Annie is now a housekeeper for
housekeeper
the rest of her life.
She's it like totally Allison. Lost that whole dynamic between the women were kind of gone because of that,
and that is problematic a little bit. I mean, the thing is, I do love this movie. I mean, the thing is, I was more familiar with this than I was with the black and white one. But I bought the DVD about 8 years back, and it has both of them on it. So that's when I first saw the black one. But I've seen the color, the 1959 version over and over again.
Right.
But and so I didn't really think much about it. But now watching the two of them, I watched them one day, the second day, and yeah, it's kind of, and Lana Turner does treat her like a servant all the way through. Oh, Annie, can you can you serve the food and serve my people for my dinner party? I'm having a party, Annie. Make sure you make sure you're there to serve everyone. Oh,
and then
Annie,
she has her daughter to serve too, and that didn't go over well. Remember what she did?
And then how does Lana Turner, I accepted you as an equal, da da da. It's like, no, not really. I mean, no. Lana Turner's character is a lot harder in this as well. She's quite, there's a hardness to her. I mean, she's not, she's not exactly the friend. She doesn't come across as the most friendliest person to come across anyway.
No, I mean, she's totally kind of standoffish in regard to, you know, her and Claudette Colbert, totally different woman, you know?
Yeah.
Not even the same woman we're talking about anymore. And then she gets hit with all the lights of Broadway, you know, and then she really kind of more into herself than she is. I don't know. She misses her daughter growing up, basically, in her pursuit of, you know, chasing the Tony Awards, you know, basically, you know.
Well, I mean, another thing is that she doesn't realize that basically the reason why she got to where she is because of Annie. I mean, Annie, okay, they meet them.
She would have been nothing without Annie. Annie was the one that was taking care of her daughter like a mother should while she was out going and, you know, while she was making the money. I get that.
Well, even before she was making the money, because the next morning she's like, you know, she takes, you know, is getting breakfast and everything sorted for them. She sorts out, she didn't pay her grocery bill. So she sorted out the grocery bill. She,
She also sorted out the rent because they were going to be kicked out. We find out that she's going to be evicted, but Annie sorts all that out. You know, she's supposed to be doing those envelopes to make extra money, but Annie ends
up doing those as well. What was the deal with the envelopes? That totally lost me. What were they doing? Did you know?
Yeah, you used to get extra money if you they gave you all the envelopes, and then basically it was a tight bunch of addresses, and you would have to handwrite the addresses and send them back to the company, and they would send them out like
personal advertisements.
It could be advertisement letters or letters to their customers, but it's what you know. It's what you did back then.
Guess somebody would have to type it all, they didn't really, printers back then, as per se we have like right next to my computer. So yeah, that would be a necessary thing to do.
Well, I remember at some point you could get jobs where people they would send you dictation. And the post would be like a tape, and you could type that up and make extra money if you had a
typewriter. They still do that. Medical transcriptionists do.
Yeah. So now you have a computer, so you don't have to do everything in carbon copies and all that stuff.
Right.
Remember carbon copies and have it type in with the carbons. And
remember the purple? What was that stuff that used to run off the printer and it smelled funny? And everybody used to
smell of alcohol.
Yeah. What was that stuff? What was that called? It wasn't a printer,
Yeah. And you had to roll it.
It was purple, though. That they was purple sometimes.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we're dinosaurs now, aren't we? Yeah. looking over the hill.
But the good thing about those days is that you could make extra money by doing shit like this. You know what I mean? But, and then Annie pretending that she was, her maid is the reason why she was getting jobs and stuff like that, acting jobs and modeling jobs, because Annie
that's true, because she gave her a little a boost of social status. She has a maid, you know, she took that one phone call. I mean, everything she really owed all of her success to the Annie, that woman who helped raise her child while she was doing her thing.
And it's quite funny because, I've seen this movie multiple times and I didn't notice it until I saw it against the black and white version, the 1934 version. And it's funny thing because Isaac watched both versions because I watched them last weekend.
Right.
And Isaac said the second one, she goes, God, it's just a white film with a couple of black people in it.
I kind of agree. It totally detracted. I don't know. It was more Hollywood. You know how they take a movie like, let's say, The Grudge from Japan, and then they Hollywood it up a little bit, and then it loses something in that westernization of that film. So it's almost like they westernized this film from the 1934 version, and it lost quite a bit of the message as far as I was concerned.
I did like the daughter, Sarah Jane.
Right.
I think that her identity about passing and being ashamed of her is a lot earlier. It happens at the very beginning. It's like, here's Sarah Jane. You can play with this doll.
She didn't want the black dolly. That's right.
She wanted the black. And then, of course, they go back. They go to the back room behind the kitchen, and she drops the black dolly. And the passing or her dissatisfaction over her own ethnicity is more prominent in this one as far as how Sarah Jane looks at it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because every time you see Sarah Jane, it's that over and over and over. Oh, give me a kiss too. Give me a kiss. You could be my mommy too. And there's a lot it's very over egged in this one.
Very. Yeah.
But then again, we also learn what happens when you get caught passing, when that her boyfriend starts beating her up in the alleyway.
Yeah, something I didn't expect out of Troy Donahue, because he was like, the boy next door, and you just don't expect him to be some racist pig of a man that's beating up this girl. And she was right. She goes, I am as white as you, and he still, knocks her around. But, and then she ends up not in a restaurant after she takes off. She ends up in it's not a strip bar, but it's a bar of, back then, moral
burlesque, I guess. Was it burlesque?
Maybe a little morally, thrifty, not thrifty is the word. I mean, it was probably morally casual, and, it's probably where good girls probably didn't work back then.
I mean, I'm also kind of wondering. I mean, it was interesting to see Sandra Gould in this.
Yeah.
Abner.
Yeah, I mean, I did a double take on that. I go, oh my god, that's what's his face? Yeah,
from Bewitched. Second Gladys number two.
Yeah, but, she's pretty young in that, wasn't she? I just never really looked at her as a younger woman. I just always looked at her as Gladys. Talk about pigeonholed into a character. You don't see her as the actress. Oh, it's Gladys.
Now, I also kind of wondering is that maybe that the reason why they kept her as a housekeeper might also help explain Sarah Jane's detestation about the whole thing, like sleeping in the back room and making and bringing the help. Because this movie, the passing was a lot more in the forefront, and the movie ends about the passing. It doesn't have that.
Right.
It's not
the
about
thing is,
all
they
of them.
Don't. But that dynamic is gone that makes them equal in partnership of a business. So she is nothing more than a maid, a nanny,
which would explain why Sarah Jane is so opposed to being like her mother.
Yeah, because she doesn't want to be waiting on the white people. I don't blame her.
She doesn't want to be in the back rooms.
If there's
a party, she wants to be at the party. She doesn't be serving at the party.
Yeah. And then, you know, and then she hands her that tray and she gets all, you know, Southern, you know, slave simple language on her and starts calling her mess or something like that. You gotta admit she had it coming, you know, take the tray, you know, I think that Lana Turner's character lost sight of what a treasure this woman was to her at that point.
She knows nothing of her. She knows nothing about her life. I mean, she's sitting
there's
there.
There's no backstory, really.
Well, let's take her death scene. You know, Annie's dying.
Right.
And, you know, as she's dying, she goes, oh, give my minx stole to the minister's wife because she always loves it. And she's like, oh, you go to church? Oh, you do this, you do that. What?
Yeah, she didn't even get to know her. She had no idea what she was doing. She had all kinds of charities.
Yeah, she had all kinds of activities and social life and people, you know, that she was hanging out with and friends. And Lana Turner's character knew nothing of any of it. So it just tells you what the hell is going on in that household.
Well, then you got Sandra D. Let's not forget Sandra D. So.
Sandra D, I think Sandra D's relationship to Annie is totally different. Sandra D, Annie is like her second mother.
Yeah, she is basically her mother. She even tells her mother, what do you know about me? You're always gone. You know?
Precisely. She goes, Annie's always there for me. Where have you been?
Yeah, and then she falls in love with Steve, who's supposed to marry her mother.
Well, I can understand this. I mean, I had to sit there and say, I can understand the Steve situation because John Gavin was a good looking guy.
So. Yeah, and he took her everywhere.
Yeah. And, you know, the thing is, you know, Sandra D's being shoved into some kind of girls' school all the time. So she's never home. Then, you know, then she sees Steve, and Steve's a good looking guy and doesn't know any. And, you know, there's no communication going on between, you know, Susie and Laura, our mother and daughter here, because she doesn't know that her mother's dating Steve. No one's told her or anything.
Yeah.
But she thinks that Steve's taking her to all these nice places because he's interested in her, not because he's dating her mom. She doesn't know anything about that. She only finds out later.
How old is she supposed to be? 16. So she's
16.
Young, impressionable girl.
I have to sit there and say, though, this one plays better than the other relationship. When you get the daughter falling in love with that guy, and the guy's like, this guy's old enough to be your grandfather. You're like, you got daddy issues.
Yeah.
At least in this one, it's like falling in love with John Gavin. It's like, you don't have daddy issues. He's good looking. It's like, I understand this. The other one's like, what the hell? What are you going after him for? He looks like a ferret. What, like an old man ferret?
Yeah, I didn't get that either. But they had the other, the little, you know, the younger black woman falling in love with that character in the other one. But this one kind of made more sense. But, you know, he was kind of leading her on a little bit. I don't understand, you know, how they were directing John Gavin in these scenes. But I could see where the 16-year-old, you know, adoring girl would look at him and not understand completely, because he was treating her like an adult, you know?
Yeah. I mean, John Gavin at this point was had a very good 3 years. He did this and did Psycho after this.
That's right.
And then he did something else after this, which is Spartacus the year after that.
Oh, yeah.
So he did like three really huge blockbusting films, one after another.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, I mean, you know, so I don't know if the reason why there's more of a disconnect between Annie and Laura, I don't know if that's and I have to sit there and say the passing in this is brought more to the foreground than in the original. The original is mentioned as part of the story, but all of them have a story. This one, the passing seems to be the forefront, and Lana Turner's career taking off. That's it. That's just two stories in here. The other stories are just kind of at the back.
Well, they did have the big funeral scene with all the bells and whistles again, but you know, in real life, the funeral scene hit real close to home for Lana Turner. I'm not sure about if that was about her real daughter in real life or whatever. She had a crazy life too. And I guess as Mahalia Jackson started singing, she lost control and fled to her trailer in tears. When no arguments could convince her to return to the church and shoot the scene, her makeup woman slapped her in the face, breaking her out of her hysterics. And then she returned to the set and completed the scene perfectly. Did not know that.
Well, this was not too long after that her daughter
got in trouble.
Lana Turner shot the guy.
But she didn't. Her daughter did. She took the blame for her daughter, I thought.
No, it was the other way around. And she had her daughter take the blame.
Maybe that's what it was. Who knows?
Because otherwise it would ruin her career.
Yeah, Lana Turner, boy, she was up there, though. She was just beautiful. She really was, even getting older. And you know, Juanita Moore plays Annie. They build her with a credit and presenting Juanita Moore as Annie Johnson, even though she'd already been in many films. Is that because she changed her name? Is that what you were saying?
No, that was in the other one.
Okay. Well, they presented her as Annie. I guess that she'd been in other films. I know I've seen her before. I'd probably have to research it to find out films, because I like old films. So, but it was kind of, you know, interesting in that. And then there was a goof when Steve and Susie go riding together. Their horses jump a low stone wall, which one of the horses knocks, revealing the whole thing to be a lightweight single piece prop. But you know, there's always a stickler for details. So
yeah,
details.
Where's Tom when you need him?
Yeah, I know. Where's Tom?
I mean, this was up for a lot more awards than the original. I mean, it did win. Kohner did win a Golden Globe for a performance, sort of thing. And Moore did win a 1959 Laurel Award, and the film won top drama. So, I mean, I thought it was interesting, because I would have thought that if I asked someone who's never seen this, which one do you think would be the most forward thinking, I would have thought to be the 1959 one. I find it hard to believe it's the 1934 one.
Exactly. But like I said, the dynamic for making it equal, or what's the word everybody uses now? Equity. What would have made it more like that is if that they had gone in and, you know, and done the Aunt Jemima thing, you know, with it, because that was great, because they aspired together, they worked together, they achieved financial success together. That is all lost in this translation. It's not here anymore. So she does become the typical, I hate to say it, I don't mean it this way, the typical, you know, black servant to this woman. And that's not what that's why the daughter was railing against life force so much. She did not want that. And I can't blame her.
It's Alice from the Brady Bunch, isn't it? It's like, oh, you're a member of the family, but you can live
but you're not.
And serve on it. And you're going to serve us. But you're not really an equal.
That's a good way to look at it. Yeah, that's exactly what it is. You know, you're not my equal.
And I think Isaac pegged it right. He said it's a white movie with a couple of black people.
He's right. It is. It's very white. It's so. It's very. I mean, not that I have a problem with it being white, But I mean, look at all the glam and glitter that it has with it. Like, you know, you do have John Gavin, you have Sandra D, you know, you got Robert Alda, you know, you got Lana. I mean, Lana Turner right there, for crying out loud, you know, the blonde bombshell herself.
It seemed like the people who were visiting Laura had more respect for Annie than Laura had.
Well, they all loved her, didn't they? Everybody loved Annie.
Yeah. And, you know, it's an odd sort of thing.
Well, God, Mahalia Jackson sang at her funeral. I mean, I wish Mahalia Jackson could sing at my funeral someday. That woman had such a beautiful gospel voice. You know, she just did. She was the queen bee. No one ever talks about her anymore. She was a beautiful singer.
I just kind of wondering, is like, I don't know how much money was she getting money put away? Was she getting paid for being there, or was she just house? We don't even know what her financial situation is. Is she totally
dependent?
She definitely
was treated better in 1934 as opposed to 1950-something, 59. I mean,
she had her own. She seemed like she had her own money here. I'm just kind of wondering if she just totally, you know, her financial status and everything like that. Just
okay.
Wait,
as a result of when Delilah's family waffle recipe, a pancake. Whatever. She's offered 20% of the profits, but she declined and chose to remain Bee's dutiful assistant. In the previous film, in this one, Paola, the character, returns going to her mother's funeral and showing remorse. It's the only scene really that was the same, was the end.
Yeah. You know,
where the daughter comes, she realizes that she's done her mother wrong all these years and that she probably should have appreciated her. You only get one mother, people. Although we might not be perfect, you can't blame us for everything, especially when you're adults. I just want to get that out there.
Well, this one ends on the funeral as well. So basically they're just in the back of the car and they're driving, you know, they're driving off the procession, and that's the way the film ends. So, you know, the other one.
I might have to read the book. The book sounds really good. I haven't read it, so I might.
It's available on Kindle form as well. Yeah. Yeah, it's available on Kindle as well. So.
Well, now that I've got my archive.org, I can find all kinds of freebies.
Yeah. But I have to also sit there and say that, you know, you don't. In the 1934 version, I think we. You know, Paola goes back to college. We get that. We got a feeling that Paola is going to come home for her holiday. She's part of the family. Here, I don't know what the hell is going to happen to Sarah Jane. I mean, after the funeral, she'd just be out in the street.
Well, what was it? Who said this? I think what I found here, I think is whoever wrote the thing for Wikipedia. Something about the racial class issues were admired for what he caught writing. What, 1997, Rob Nelson said, basically, we're left to intuit that the black characters and the movie are themselves products of 50s era racism, which explains the film's perspective, but hardly makes it less dizzying. I don't know what, you know, it's the mixed. I don't know. It lost something in translation with this. I mean, it was still a good film. I don't hate it in any measure, but I did like with Claudette, Colbert, and what was her name? What was the actress's name? Who played her in Imitation of Life in 1934? Who was that actress?
Claudette Colbert.
Not Claudette Colbert. Delilah. Louise Beavers?
Yeah, Louise Beavers.
Yeah, but there was something more of a bond. There was something more cohesive. You know, in the end of this, in the 59 version, you see that I think maybe Lana Turner maybe didn't appreciate her so much through life and the friendship that she basically had, because she seems really tore up when this woman dies. And basically, she doesn't really. I think she just dies of a broken heart. Is that really what you were letting?
Well, no, she's feeling ill for a while.
Okay,
she's
that's like, right. Oh, I don't that's feel right. Very well. She was getting tired. Feel very well. Yeah,
and there's a lot of that going on. So, I mean, the first one, she dies from a broken heart.
Okay,
this one, I think is. I don't. We're not really quite sure what she's dying from, but it seems like being something that's long standing.
Right.
I don't know if she's going. Obviously, she's not going to the doctor or whatever. She is. No one's telling us anything. But it's quite interesting that Sirk later said that he had deliberately and subversively undercut Turner to draw focus towards the problems of the two black characters. So saying that, there could have been a lot of scenes around the cutting room floor that might have evened things out, but he wanted to make this more about the passing, which I said before, the 1959 is more about the passing and about the black character. What's going on between those two? That's the dramatic sense that's going on in the movie is between those two. And then you got, and Lana Turner's character, that doesn't really hold the drama. That's just like,
well, her glamour almost overshadows the concept of the movie too, you know?
For me, it just like, that was the only interesting part of the movie. I mean, it was interesting, but it's kind of like A Star Is Born. We've seen so many of those stylizes.
Yeah.
All About Eve, all that sort of stuff. And this was kind of like her rising, but the emotional resonance in the movie is between the Annie and Sarah Jane. That's the emotion part of the movie. Because if Lana Turner dies, you're like, oh, she died. But because Annie dies, you actually feel it. You know what I mean? And that's the whole dynamics of the movie. So it's interesting. And I'm kind of wondering if, because Lana Turner's a big star and she was known to be a force to be reckoned with, I guess.
Yes.
To put it there. So I'm kind of wondering is like what was written and what was taped that was cut out to move these two characters forward.
It's got to be out there somewhere. That's probably something I'll do later, is probably go look for the cutting room floor stuff, because that would be interesting to find out what happened. You know that they had to cut stuff. You knew that they did. Mm-hmm. So what was sacrificed, you know?
Yeah. Now, interestingly enough, this film is the basis, was the inspiration and homage for the Todd Haynes film, Far From Home, which starred Julia Moore, that was up for a bunch of Oscars back in 2002. And it also was the inspiration for the 1969 Diana Ross and Supremes hit I'm Living in Shame and the 2001 REM song Imitation of Life, which are both based on this film.
I did not know that.
Didn't know that either.
Learn something new every day.
Yes. So I think what we'll do is let's discuss both films together. Which is your favorite version and why?
I liked the 1934 version better. Not that I'm dissing 1959 at all, but I really liked the relationship of the women in that version. I liked that there was that equality between the two of them and that they were helping each other get through life and that both of them had equal return on it as in friendship. You know, they took care of each other. You know, they both had two daughters that were little pissers sometimes. I mean, let's face it, kids are kids. It doesn't matter what color they are. And I just like the dynamic of the business together and cooking in front of the window on the shore, you know, it just put more into it. And it just made more sense to me other than the 1959 one, which was A Star Is Born. You're right.
Yeah.
Kind of, sort of.
For me, I love the relationship between the two women. And I think that was a lot stronger than 1934. I think the 1959 version for me, I loved that the whole Sarah Jane dynamic of her, except your mom was a lot stronger in that one.
Yeah.
And a lot more prominent. It was a bit more, it gave it a bit more understanding. And I liked the 1934 ending that the daughter's gonna go back to college.
Yeah, the daughter still has a family. You really are left up in the air. I mean, she is with them, but you're right. I just can't see them kicking her out. I'm assuming that Lana Turner kept her.
I'm assuming that basically she's not a part of that family. I don't know.
Well, she doesn't seem to want to be part of that family. She doesn't want to be treated like a servant. And she wants I don't blame her. I would have left too.
Well, I think Paola in the 1934, I think that, you know, and Claudette Colbert's version, I think that she goes to college, she becomes part of the family, she's going to be there on Christmases. When she ever gets married and has children, it's part of an extended family. The 1959 one, however, I just got a feeling that, you know, because Lana Turner is so all about her and how it looks on her and everything's so surface for her, because we get a lot, you know, it seems to be a lot about that. So, you know, when Lana Turner, you know, she's crying in the coffin and stuff like this, and I, you know, and it's very.
She did get really upset. She started to do an Olivia hussy.
Well, I kind of wondered that she dragged her away because it's like, oh, come on, Sarah Jane, don't worry to come across there because you're embarrassing me. Or was it because she cared about what she felt? Because when they go back in the car, you know.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
You know, the three of them there, you know, all four of them in the car.
I think it's because, like, she was embarrassing her. She really, I mean, there was a lot of people in.
I don't know, though. Like, maybe she was there because she cared about Sarah Jane, or maybe she's like, you're embarrassing me. Just get in the car, sort of thing.
Just get the car, yeah. You're making a scene. But, everybody's watching. Get the car.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, so you're not quite sure, but I have to sit there and say in the 1934 film, though, because at least Sarah Jane gets in the back seat with those, with Sandra Dee and John Gavin and Lana Turner. In the 1934, though, do you remember when she cries at the coffin and she goes back into the car? Do you realize that they're in the back of the car and she's sitting in the front seat?
Yeah, that was a nice touch.
Yeah, so I thought to myself, it was like, is that because there's segregation between those two? But then we don't get that. But here we get that epilogue situation where we don't get an epilogue here. That movie just ends with them driving behind the
professor. There's no closure we get the epilogue. Movies do that. You know, I almost wish they would have wrote another book or whatever. What happened to her after that, you know, when her mother dies? What was her life like, you know?
Well, the 1959 one. I mean, I think the 1934 film leaves it so you kind of have an idea what it's going to be like. I think
right here,
the big payoff is the funeral, isn't it? That's the big emotional. That's so basically, like, when the lights come up, you're sitting there crying your eyes out. And that's how they want you in the 59 one.
Yeah, it was sad, though. Both endings were sad. You know, I appreciated both of them, but I just liked the women, the relationship, the bond they had starting that business together. I think it detracted in that, like in the night, I don't know why they did what they did. And then instead of, you know, making them business partners, why would they make her a servant in her house like that? I think
it's to push the passing things. I think it's to push the Sarah Jane. This one, I mean, that's the second one. I'm thinking at it now. I think in the 1959 version, I think it's to push the Sarah Jane storyline to the forefront. Because the 1934 film, it's part of the story, but it's not the whole story. It's just part of the story. Do you know what I mean? It's not as the 1934 film is about passing, but it's about a lot of other stuff as well. It's about two women being treated as serious business women. It's considered it's also the sexism that's going on a little bit in the 19th. You got a little bit of that.
Well, it addressed a whole lot of that. And you know what really kind of bothered me in the 1959 version is when was it John Gavin or who was it that was telling her she can't go and do whatever she wanted to do? Because he says, I don't like it, so you're not going. And I would have, you know me. Nobody's the boss of me, but I was just wondering, where does he get off on that? You know, you can't go. I mean, there was other things other than racism addressed in this.
Yeah. But I do think the past night, I was, if I'm thinking of the two films, Imitation of Life, 1934 is about two women in the relationship and has some stuff about passing and other stuff. The 1959 version, I just think it's a film about passing. That's how I think of the film.
You're right.
So I'm kind of wondering if maybe that's the reason.
If you look at the movie posters, are totally telling, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, there's none of the black character even in the 1934 poster.
You know.
They're in the 1959 poster, but they're kind of like in the bottom.
Yeah, but
right
she's
corner.
Way down here in the 1950. You know, I mean, it's so, you know, and you know, you gotta wonder why people are so pissed all the time. I get it. I do get it.
Yeah, but I do think that the 1959. I think they because they were pushing the passing storyline a lot harder.
I never heard that term until this movie. I've never even knew that term.
You didn't. There's a new Amazon TV series about that deals with it as well now. a new drama series.
But they really don't have to do that anymore, do they? Unless they-
In some cultures they do. In India, where they have the class system. The class system.
That goes without saying. I'm surprised that's still there.
That's still there. It does happen in some African countries as well. Lighter skinned blacks have a lot more easier than darker skins in African countries. You get it in China, that if you're a bit lighter and fairer, that you have a lot more opportunities.
Oh, I definitely stay out of China being a minority, because they're going to probably try to sell your orchids. So try to stay out of China.
But I mean, you got it in Japan. You got it in some Japanese cultures as well. You know, if you look a certain way or this, or we have it. You know, we have it in our culture as well. I mean, we have the class system here. I mean, you know, you get people pretending they're a different class. What's Inventing Anna about?
Yeah.
You know, that's about someone who's, you know, born outside the class system and is poor and pretending she's part of the class system and passing for higher class than what she actually is.
Right.
So we don't, you know, so we got passing going on. It's just different in different ways.
Yeah, I guess that's true. I just never heard the term. I thought when I first, excuse my ignorance, I really didn't understand that term. I had to look it up. That's why I asked you as well what you thought it was. I thought when she went in the first movie, she thought she was talking about passing. I thought she was talking about the school, you know, she was trying to pass herself off. But why did she allow her to pass herself off as a white person anyway in that particular school? Because there were no other colored children there.
Because the education's better. You know, let's put it this way. You have children and you can either send them to the school. All they have to do is pretend that they're Protestant, but that's the best school. So you want to, so you just send your kids there and just pretend you're Protestant. You might be Catholic, but if you're Protestant, you can go to this school because they're not going to let you in if you're Catholic. So just say anything.
Back in the day, I used to, you know, I didn't want to go to Catholic school. I didn't want to. And down here, people are tripping over themselves to put their children in Catholic school and get them out of the public school system.
Well, the Catholic schools back home were poor and had bad books and they were taught. They weren't very good. There wasn't a very great education, because I know I went to IHC for a little while. I was shocked
till the eighth grade, from kindergarten to eighth. And let me tell you, though, I was reading books in the eighth grade that they didn't even get to. They were starting them in 10th grade. So it's just like, wow, I already read Tale of Two Cities in eighth grade. So I don't know.
I mean, I didn't go to Watertown school, so I don't know what the regular education, but Sackett's Harbor, where I went to school, I was further advanced at IHC when I went to IHC than they were. And I was like, this is a bit weird for me.
Yeah.
But I don't know what I mean, but maybe it's because, you know, we don't spend an hour a day or every other day teaching religious studies. We're doing something else. So maybe that's it. I tried to black out
that 1 year of IHC for my memory. I don't remember much about that year.
I didn't like it at all. I thought it was horrendous.
It was awful. The people that went there
were a bunch of idiots and they thought they were better than everyone else. And there's a lot of bullying going on there as well.
Lots of bullying.
And I was quite shocked by that, actually. I mean, I didn't last long. I was only there for like 2 months.
Well, I lasted a year and then went to Catholic. Or no, I went to Watertown High because I begged my mother, I'm going to quit school if I have to stay here. I can't do it. It was so alien to me. I just didn't like how things were going there. Things are different now, though. I mean, we don't have. Things are totally different. We don't have the abuse that was going on. Well, there's abuse probably going on, but, you know, you didn't have a bunch of penguins hitting you over the head with dictionaries all the time either, or yelling at you because your boobs came in sixth grade. people.
I mean, I don't know what it's like now, but in the end of the day, I mean, I got kicked out for hitting a nun because I was just sitting there. She hit me in the back of the head with the
just
ruler.
Just one.
And I just swung around and I got hit. So I didn't know who fucking hit me. So I ran around and smashed her and then knocked her on her backside. And then the next thing I know, I got kicked out. So it's like, you know, I didn't like beat her up or anything like that. I just swung. It's like I got hit and I just swung, you know.
God, they used to lock us in closets and everything. It was just awful. Just awful.
Yeah.
They were awful to girls. I got sick of hearing about the abuse of the altar boys. No one ever said anything about what they did to us. Like, screw this.
Yeah, it's an education.
It was an experience, to say the least.
It gives you war stories to tell your children later on. So.
Yeah, well, you know, I always laugh because, you know, they say I walked in the snow. Well, I actually did walk in the snow to school, you know, about a mile.
We had a snowmobile every once in a while as well.
Oh, God, so. Man. That's what it used to snow all the time, though. But back then, even in our school back in the 60s and the 70s, I mean, even if we did have other people of different races, and we didn't think nothing of it. I didn't care. I know the other students didn't care. And it just seems like it only cares. People only care when you start being told you need to care. And that's where all the bullshit starts. It's just it's all fine until somebody, you know, starts with their shitty narrative.
So, I guess, do you got anything more you want to add about Imitation?
No, I really like I said, I like 34 better. I thought the message was stronger. Like you said, 1950, whatever Isaac said, I totally agree.
Yeah, I have to agree. Didn't think of it that way. After you said it, it's like I couldn't get out of
it. It makes more sense after I thought of that, because seriously, there really wasn't. Well, Mahalia Jackson, she was there. She was a really prominent too. I didn't, you know, she was just, God, man, she could belt out the Christmas carols too. I always remembered her music growing up.
She wanted, I think, didn't she win a Pulitzer or something as well?
I can't remember, but man, that woman was just, boy, she could.
We studied
her
in school. She was part of one of the people that we studied in school. So I guess that brings us to the end of Imitation of Life, our first Make-Remake episode. Our next Make-Remake will be The Shining by Stanley Kubrick and the TV miniseries, which was written by Stephen King. So we got two versions of The Shining, both based on the Stephen King book, one very much like the Stephen King book, and the other one very little like the Stephen King book.
You got me confused. We're not watching this with Jack Nicholson. We're not doing that one.
We're doing Jack Nicholson Shining and the TV miniseries.
Rebecca De Mornay one.
Both of them.
Okay. Rebecca De Mornay. Well, no, because there's been another version. And yep, it's like, no, we're not doing that one. No, I we're like doing the Rebecca De Mornay version.
Yeah, that's the Jack Webber, Rebecca De Mornay version.
I haven't seen that in eons. I'm going to have to dig that out somewhere.
Yeah. So that'll be The Shining, the original Kubrick film version and the miniseries that came out in 2004. Right. And of course, next week we'll be doing Dark Shadows, which we'll be doing a Dark Shadows retrospective. Our next Books and Screen the week after that is Let the Right One In, and we'll be doing the Swedish film Let the Right One In, and then we'll be back doing our 80s, which we'll be doing Necromantic, which is a 1980s German film, and Basket Case from 1986. So it's good night for myself, a good night, Vicky.
Good night, everybody.
And see you next time.